The topic is about introduction to chakras. And it's part of yoga. See, the stages of yoga is that we start from the physical part, and we do the exercises, and then we go into the breathing part, and after that we go into the relaxation. And then after the relaxation, we go into the meditation part. So this is the evolution. But sometimes you find that some people start from the meditation, that they don't do the physical exercises, they start with the meditation. And which one do you think is popular out there, meditation or the physical exercise? Physical exercise. You'll be surprised to know that there are more people in this world who practice meditation than the physical yoga. How many billion people are there on this earth? 7 billion. There are 7 billion people on earth. Less than half a billion practice the asanas. Almost 2 billion people practice meditation. So it's very interesting, isn't it? This revelation, we've been thinking that the physical yoga is more popular. But the other aspect of this revelation is that the meditation is practiced as a religious kind of activity. It is part of a certain, it's part of religions. So therefore, if the approach is on that basis, the religious practice, therefore I need to practice it. So it becomes a little bit more kind of regulated. Right? There is a regulation there. It, because religion is quite strong, right? It has a very strong impact in our mind. Forces the willpower. And I need to do it. And I need to do this meditation because it is part of my religion. All the cultures that come from India, they have great affinity towards meditation. They like to close their eyes and like to meditate. What is the purpose of meditation? They want to find some peace, because they cannot find peace with the eyes open. So they think that let's find peace with the eyes closed. And find that after some time, many practitioners of meditation do not continue. Most of those who practice meditation, after some time they give up, because they don't seem to find those things which are advertised that you can find in meditation. I can find some form of joy and all that. They can't find, so they give up. And quite a number of people who practice meditation end up with some kind of what they call as a psychosomatic illnesses. One is that a kind of break takes place in the mind. Now, when I close my eyes and the idea is to bring some higher ideals into the system, right? That meditation is supposed to be a spiritual experience, alright? It is supposed to bring a higher awareness. It is supposed to bring some form of evolution in my characteristics. The most common emotion, it is not love, it is jealousy. So, this is what I am supposed to feel. I am not supposed to feel. When I close the eyes in spiritual world, I am not supposed to feel jealousy. But I close my eyes, the car that was brought by my friend, bought by my neighbor, comes into the picture. I am not supposed to feel jealous. I am meditating. This is a spiritual experience. But why is this car bought by my neighbor coming into my mind? What is that emotion? Is it your blessing them, buy more cars? Let me drive my old car, 12 years old, doesn't matter, but you continue to buy a new car. I bless you. Is this what is coming? Quite rare. Normally what will come is a bit of frustration. Why is he able to buy a car, but I remember you're supposed to meditate, right? Supposed to be meditating, but this persistent thought comes in. This picture of the thing that you don't want to think about. You don't want to be jealous. You don't want to have this anger. But the person you are angry about comes to the mind. The person who did something in your office which you felt offended when you are trying to meditate comes into the mind. I don't want this. I don't want to think about this person. But why is this person coming and all that he or she has done to me in my office which created this feeling of anger, of frustration, of irritation is coming to my mind. But I don't want to. But it's coming to my mind. I want to have a peaceful time. I want to find peace. Right? I want to find salvation, nirvana, satori, enlightenment. But what comes is this person whom I think is bullying me, or who is creating this anger in me, or this jealousy. All those things which I don't want is coming to my mind. So what happens eventually? What happens eventually is that the mind splits. The mind which is trying to experience spirituality splits away from the mind which is experiencing base emotions. What is happening now? There is a split. Meditation is supposed to bring oneness, one-pointedness. But what happens in modern living, meditation has brought greater split. That's the reason why I have seen many individuals who have taken mantra diksha. You know, they've been given a mantra and they're supposed to chant one whole beat. It's about 108. So they chant, but they chant not with pleasure, but with pressure. That I have to finish this one round. You know, very restless, I have to finish another five. So again, what is happening? A split. Some others are given an image that they're supposed to chant and then have this image. But as they are focusing on the image and chanting, the mind becomes very stressed. It is not used to that. So again, there's a fight. There's a stress of the mind wanting to achieve this, but the natural state of the mind is to go back to its thoughts. It wants to think about the things that is happening in its life. It wants to complain, it wants to talk, it wants to be talkative. But then again, you are again and again, the mind is forced. So what happens eventually? Again, there is a break. So we have found that the approach to meditation seems to be creating the opposite effect. Trying to be spiritual but then getting confused. So eventually they say the only way to find spirituality is to detach. That is the only way. For me to go to a monastery, for me to spend a few weeks in an ashram, go there, leave everything and then attain something, some form of enlightenment and then come back. Because you see, it is impossible for me to practice this training here in this life. I mean in this current situation. Because this is too much of pressure to the mind. So this is the general state that is being experienced by almost everyone who embarks on a journey of meditation. Because it is very abstract. Meditation is very abstract. What do I concentrate upon? How can I continue to chant this continuously when my mind is being bombarded by different kinds of emotions? Seems to be a big struggle happening. So now comes this chakras. Chakra seems to be quite popular. There has been many books written, not only by Indian authors, but also by Western authors. Big literature, huge amount of literatures. And because of this big, huge bombardment of information regarding chakra, again, there's a lot of confusion. If you look at the Western aspect of writing about chakras, and the Indian way of writing about the chakras, it's different. And then you have the Tibetan schools also write about the chakras. And then you have the Japanese Zen schools which are also trying to move into, because it's very popular. The main thing is, where is the chakra, why the chakra is relevant in our lives, and how can we approach this mechanism, and what can it do for us. So this is what we are going to explore. It's going to be a very basic introduction, because it's an introduction. We will see what are these chakras, where they are situated, and then some form of concentration on them to awaken the qualities of these chakras. There is a general tendency to fight against the mind when we do some form of meditation, correct? The general tendency of the mind is to wander. You keep the eyes closed, also it's wandering all over the place. When we bring it to one point, what will happen to the mind? It will become very stressed, right? So the way of meditation is to pull the mind to something, even though it is kind of an elevated or a worshipful image, to bring it, still it is unhappy. The way to focus on the chakras is slightly different. The chakras are situated along the spine. It is not abstract, it is part of the internal physiology. We can't prove the existence. One man tried to prove it, and he was successful, and he created some devices to measure the electrical impulses in all those places that have been depicted in the ancient text. They say this is where this chakra is, and he created some machines, some medical devices, and he was able to measure that these points along the spinal pathway have high levels of electrical impulses. So he was able to prove. But we don't know about it. Some say that this discovery is as big a discovery as Einstein's theory of relativity. But this was not popular, because who wants to know about the chakras in the mainstream? Nobody, because it's a spiritual science. So he was able to do this. And who is this person? Have you heard about this person? The person who was able to prove the existence of the chakras, and he was able to measure that these chakras were existing through his discovery of these machines, which shows that there is intense electrical activity in these parts along the spine. Who is this person? You have not heard. This man is a Japanese scientist by the name of Hiroshi Motoyama. He wrote a book about chakras, bridges of chakras, bridges to higher consciousness. So he wrote, and then he also published about his machines, and his machines are available in some parts of the world, in some research facilities which are researching psychic abilities, and also in his center, parapsychological research center in Japan. But I don't think he is alive many years ago. Now coming back to these chakras. So the chakras are along the spine, and it has been proven to exist in us. It exists. Maybe it's existing in a lower microelectrical impulses. There is not enough charge for it to penetrate and to be felt. But some practitioners of yoga, and some by accidentally triggering this, they are able to feel these places where the impulses are very strong. There's a reason why some people say there is a kind of a sensation here at this trikuti, or in this middle of the brain, at the top of the head, or along the spinal pathway. Some people have this kind of awakening. They don't know. And many people in Western countries who have had this kind of experiences, and they start seeing visions and feelings and speaking philosophies, in the 60s, they were sent to mental hospitals. Because people couldn't People couldn't understand them. What are they talking about? Their lifestyle changed. They started, you know, doing things which were very strange and funny. But now people have greater understanding. The only country which is tolerant to this kind of awakening is in India. Only in India these people are allowed, not only allowed to live, but also they are looked upon highly. They don't call them madmen, even though they act in such a way, because they are beyond the confines of society, but they are worshipped as great saints and philosophers and yogis. Though some may be illiterate, in some of the villages in India, they are the ones people go to for some form of advice and consultation, but they have no studies, they have never studied in their life. They don't know any alphabets, but they speak profound philosophy. Now we will move into the structure of the chakras. Now the chakras are situated along the spine, and there are flows of energy which are moving along the spine. There are three flows. One is called the Ida, the left flow, which is associated with the parasympathetic nervous system, which brings us a state of relaxation. And in TCM, or traditional Chinese medicine, it is called the Yin, on the left side. And on the right side, starting from the base of the spine, is called the Pingala, or in TCM is called the Yang. So you have the Ida on the left side, and you have the Pingala on the right side, Yin and Yang. And then you have a central pathway. It is called the Sushumna, the central pathway. So these three flow in this manner. They start from the base of the spine, and then Ida starts from the left, Pingala starts from the right. They start from the point which has the first chakra. It's called the Muladhara chakra, at the base of the spine. For males, it is at the perineum, in between the scrotum and the anus. For females, it is at the posterior of the cervix. So it starts from there, that is Muladhara, and then the right goes up, the left goes, and then they cross at the coccyx, tailbone. So this is the point of Swadhisthana, the second chakra, and then they go. So from here, Ida goes from the left, Pingala goes to the right, and then they cross. When they cross, the Pingala, which is the Yang, has now gone to the left. So it is not exclusively right flow or exclusively left flow. They do penetrate into the other dimension. So that is where we get the balance. Right now, if there is no balance, it shows that these flows are not happening. When these flows are happening, you have that feeling of balance of both the emotion and rational thinking, of love and hate. So this kind, I mean, hate is not good, but the kind of, we can balance it. Right now we can't balance. If we love obsessively, right? Or we hate until we send them to we burn them, we get them arrested. So that kind of thing. So there's no balance, extreme behavior. Even children are exhibiting this extreme behavior now. I think yesterday there was one, a mother came. She said that her daughter is in form 5, and she told the mother that I want to get all A's. If I don't get all A's, I will commit suicide. It's an ultimatum, and this is serious. She said that if you don't push me, I'm going to commit suicide, and I'm not playing the fool. What's happening? How? What has the balance? So what happened to the mother? Mother became depressed. That's why she came and saw me. So the whole everything is affected. So coming back to this. So the balance goes in. So from Swadhisthana at the coccyx, tailbone, the Yang goes to the Yin, and then the Yin goes to the Yang. This is where the balance takes place. That's why this playing with these chakras provides such beautiful balance in our lives. So it goes in. And then it crosses behind the navel. That point behind the navel is the Manipura chakra. It crosses. It crosses in and then it goes up and it crosses behind the chest. This is called the Anahata chakra. It crosses at the back of the neck. That is called the Visuddhi. And finally they end at the middle of the head inside the brain, and that is called the Ajna chakra. Old time they call it Ajna. Nowadays we call it Ajna. But in Sanskrit it's not Ajna, it's Ajna. But it's quite difficult to pronounce, so we pronounce it Ajna. So every time the left and right energies, the Ida and Pingala or the Yin and Yang, they cross, where they cross, there is a formation of a very powerful energy. It is like those, it's like clashing and producing an explosion. So the chakras are not entities which are all the time there. It is only available when the energies flow and cross. So that is the reason why we cannot sometimes be able to feel it. Only certain individuals are able to feel. It's because their energy is already flowing. It is not only by the practice of yoga that we can find it. By the practice of different things, like for example creativity, by the practice of Tai Chi, Qi Kung, all these you can experience it. Even by the practice of certain forms of soft martial arts, one can achieve this awakening of these energies.